Bob of a single dad's from the Midwest, we can talk about it. Bob of a single dad's from the Midwest, we can talk about it. Bob of a single dad's from the Midwest, we can talk about it. Or we can get gully, y'all size up your body and put some white chalk around it.
Welcome to the Single Dads of the Midwest, episode 49. We're almost at 50, almost halfway there. This is actually the first episode being recorded in the calendar year of 2024. I'm joined by two amazing friends, and Mark and Claire, to talk about one of her favorite shows, I Think You Should Leave with Tim Robinson, a sketch comedy show. So before I get into an introduction of how I personally got into the show, I'll let Mark and Claire introduce themselves. They're both amazing people in their own way, but I'll let them go. Claire, if you want to go first.
Sure. Thanks for having me on the show, Alex. My name is Claire, and I was introduced to the show by some friends of mine in Atlanta. We had been at a music festival all weekend, you know, just smoking lots of weed. And we came back to the apartment and they were like, we have something important to show you. And I think we watched like two seasons in one sitting. So yeah, big fan of the show. Excited to discuss.
Nice. Mark?
Hi, everybody. Mark Lieberman here. I've actually been on Single Dads of the Midwest before. I don't remember the episode number, but if you remember the Halt and Catch Fire episode, that was me. Happy to be back talking about another great TV show. Very different show from the other one. But I honestly don't remember exactly what motivated me to start watching the show, except that I knew who Tim Robinson was before the show because he was a cast member on Saturday Night Live, I think only for one or two seasons. He didn't really get a ton of screen time, but he had sort of a memorable presence as his future work has sort of borne out. There's one particular sketch that I remember that really stood out at the time. It's called Z Shirt. It was like a taped sketch that he did with Kevin Hart. It's really hard to describe, and it's not even really that similar to the tone of I Think You Should Leave, but it just really stood out to me at the time. And so when I heard he was doing a Netflix comedy show, I was like, oh, that's interesting. And then it just sort of became a bit of a social media phenomenon. Like, I just kept seeing memes from it. You know, certain sketches I'm sure we'll talk about have kind of taken on a life of their own. And so I just kind of kept being exposed to it. And it's like, okay, I should probably check out what's going on here. And then and then I did, and, you know, never looked back. So yeah, that's my story.
Nice. And I actually, my introduction is through Mark. So Mark came over to live when I was in LA. In 2021, I believe it was July of 2021. And I remember this very specifically because I had also been dealing with a breakup, a lot of like physical injuries, and I was skeptical of the show. And then like Mark and I watched this and it was like, you know, just straight like laughter injected right into the veins. And it was so good. And like, I was like, oh, I know I've made it when I found a girl that like, I think you should leave. But it turns out everyone seemingly that I ran into loves the show, and maybe it's also living in LA. But then it was once I left LA, I realized this was a little bit more niche than I thought. I think it's like a cult favorite. Like a lot of the people that like it are really into it, like us. But not everyone knows it. So I was curious your all's experience with like having seen the show that's popular, but not say in the zeitgeist in the same way like The Office or Parks and Rec was. Like, do you run into a lot of people that see this show or have seen the show?
I would say no. And I have tried to show it to different groups of people, and the reaction is usually pretty like baffled and negative. Like, what the hell was that? That was so stupid. A particular favorite of mine is the scene where he crashes into the clothing store and he's in the hot dog car and in a hot dog costume, which I thought was like the peak of comedy. And people are like, that was really stupid. I don't see the appeal. But the people who are into it, like Alex and the two of us, love it and can like quote lines from like every single skit. So it's definitely niche, but it's really fun to encounter other people who like the show, even though it's pretty rare.
Yeah, I mean, I like I said, I had sort of gotten exposed to it originally through like that hot dog sketch. Actually, is one of the ones I'm thinking of that kind of like became a meme online and almost sort of became like a sort of like symbol of Trump era mania, where it's like the guy's telling you that it's one thing, but it's like you can see that even when he's saying it that he's lying. There's just something about that kind of resonated in that period of time, I think. But I mean, yeah, when I watched the show, even I, it took me a little bit to like really sort of get on its wavelength. But once I did, I kind of sort of seemed to me like the kind of show that I could introduce to some people and they would love it, and to other people and they would hate it. And Alex was someone that I sort of thought would have a taste for it. Yeah, just because it is, I think like it's kind of brash and obnoxious on the surface. And also there is a certain conceit that the show is just sort of repeating over and over again in sort of different variations, that if you, for whatever reason, don't kind of like buy into the conceit, then you're kind of always going to be disappointed. Which is not to say that I think the show is too repetitive or anything like that. I don't think it is at all. But yeah, I mean, I'm trying to think. I guess I know other people who like it. I don't know if I know anybody who specifically like hates it or was exposed to it and was like, this isn't for me. But I will say that the third season of the show, I feel like, has been a little less warmly received in general than the first two. I feel like it hasn't, I haven't seen as many of the sketches like sort of, again, resonating online or like even like finding mm-hmm. them to be quite as quotable as the first two, not necessarily in terms of quality, but just how much people paid attention to them. So I don't know if that's something, but yeah, it is kind of fun that it sort of straddles the line between something that's obviously mainstream enough to be on Netflix and to be an Emmy winning show and to have famous people in it, but you know, niche enough that like you can watch it and not feel like you're, you know, watching the same thing literally everybody else on earth is. So yeah, it's a fun balance.
Yeah, I would say my experience actually probably more mirrors Claire, because when I have tried to show it to friends, I've also been met with that same sort of negative reaction of like, what the hell is this? And what's funny is I think the hot dog skit is one of the most externally humorable ones, like one I would yeah. think other people, like even if they hadn't seen the show, would enjoy, and yet somehow it doesn't hit.
I mean, that's one of the ones where like you can more easily if a person hasn't seen it, you can explain it sort of in words and it kind of yeah. like makes sense. Where some of the other ones, like you could explain it for an hour and like it would never become more legible than if you just watched it. Yeah, I was also going to say, like, maybe you guys just need better friends, you know?
That is true. I mean, I don't have friends always introduce me to shows.
Better like taste, you know?
Yeah, it does seem to make people uncomfortable or just like unsettled. I would say like the common thread between a lot of the sketches are like someone gets a little bit like socially embarrassed and then takes it way too far. Specifically like the printer skit with Patty Harrison in the office, and she keeps like screaming like Santa jokes. I think that like that level of like cringe and absurdity like makes people like, this is weird, like this is too much. But of course some people love it.
And maybe it's like also like if you like British comedy, you're more likely to like it. I know Claire and I both enjoy Peep Show, among other and things, and it sort of also has that sort of cringe dry. Some of it is more dry depending on thing. And it's interesting that I feel like not a single skit has broken through. I think of like the show Key and Peele, where even if you hadn't seen it, almost everyone knows the substitute teacher or the college football name skit. But like I think even though, like you said, Mark, some skits were famous and more tweeted and more quotable, there was no one skit that truly had a like breakthrough moment. And it's also, in fairness to like the time frame of Key and Peele, there's so many other shows out there. So it's so hard unless you're like a Game of Thrones, Breaking Bad, top tier show where everyone would know.
Yeah, I think that's part of it. I mean, I think that, yeah, part of it is just that like the landscape of available viewing options is so vast now that it's like just harder for anything to kind of break through on that level. I mean, I would say that I think the two things that have gotten closest to that would be the hot dog sketch, which, like I said, is sort of like been adopted as like a symbol of a certain political moment. But then the other one that I feel like has gotten closest to that, at least in terms of, again, like how often you see the memes, you know, is the steering wheel guy. The focus group. And that is something that I think is sort of what's a little bit mysterious about the appeal of the show, even to me, someone who likes it, is like that's a sketch I've watched. Like, I, no matter how many times I watch it, it's always funny. And like, I can watch it like 3 times in a row when it's funny. I can watch it, you know, I can wait 6 months to turn it back on, and it's still like, there's just something kind of endlessly rewatchable about it. And I would say that extends to kind of the whole show. I mean, the show as a whole, like, it's, you know, it's these 15-minute episodes. Each one has 3 or 4 sketches. There's only 6 episodes in a season. Like, you can kind of watch the whole thing. Like, it's pretty like easily digested, but it sort of like rewards repeat viewing, or at least doesn't like diminish the more you watch it, I guess, or at least for me it doesn't. But
I think in terms of like sketches breaking through into the mainstream, the Pay It Forward skit, I've actually seen that a lot. I've seen a lot of iterations of that 55 burgers, because it's
I'm doing something important.
Yeah, it's like easy to like replace the fast food with other things. So it's like, it's very memeable, but many of the skits are not quite as memeable.
No, that's
well, some fair. Of it too. Although, is like, yeah. Oh, go ahead, Alex.
I was just going to say, that's the only skit I remember from season 3.
I feel like
season 3 was the weakest.
I liked, I actually hadn't seen season 3 until Alex asked me to be on this podcast, which again is like, when the second season came out, I was like, I have to watch this immediately. That was around the time when I saw you, Alex. I think I just started the second season, and I saw you, and I was like, I need to finish this. Like, let's go. Third season came out, and like, part of it was just the reaction to it was a little more tepid, and I don't know what else was going on in my life at the time, but I just didn't like make a point to watch it. Which maybe says something about just, I mean, I think part of the thing too is like, you know, I mean, it happened with Key and Peele. It happens with any sort of like comedy phenomenon like this. Like, part of the appeal of it is like, I can't believe this thing is so fully formed and kind of like unique, and that its perspective is so different from other things that I'm used to seeing. And at a certain point, that goes away, even if you still like and appreciate what it's doing. Like, the novelty of it does wear off a little bit, which I think maybe is part of what happened in the third season. I did enjoy the what is it, the driving crooner sketch from the third season?
Like that one.
So that's interesting, because I mean I feel like that was one where you sort of start to see like there is a formula to many of the sketches, right? It's like it's him, you know, it's Tim Robinson, and like he seems kind of normal but like a little off, and then like the deeper you go into his psyche, like the more problems you find.
I saw a bunch of cosplays of the driving crooner at a convention I went to. Someone had like an actual like bar window that he was carrying around. Whoa. I appreciate that skit, because it's just ridiculous.
I don't know. That just didn't hit for me, but I'm glad you guys liked it. That's the thing, is like only maybe 1 or 2 skits per episode hit, but the ones that hit were like golden.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, my personal favorite, and Alex knows this because I watched it with him. I think maybe I'd seen it one time before I showed you, Alex. But my favorite one is the sloppy steaks. for me, because like that one, I think is one of the only ones in the entire run of the series that like, and it's very subtle, but like there is kind of like something like a little bit emotional about the end of that sketch, where it's sort of, where it flashes back to when he used to be a piece of shit, and they're all like doing the stakes, and you see the baby on the beach, and like there's that like kind of tender moment where he's seeing the baby, and the baby's kind of you know, looking at him and regarding him as someone who will eventually recover from this phase of his life. And I don't know, like the Vampire Weekend guy is singing in the background, and like, I don't know, it's just kind of that sketch like sort of for me goes to like another level that I don't know if this show's ever really found again. On top of the fact that just the concept of a sloppy steak is just so beautiful. Claire, I don't know if you know this, but one person in this Zoom session right now has actually consumed a sloppy steak.
Oh, really?
His name is Alex.
I did go to an Outback Steakhouse, and Mark has seen a video, and I did. This is what I can eat. I did throw water on the steak. I was just so curious. I was worried they would kick me out. But I will say it enhances the flavor by, like, you know, 5-10%, but it's not like game breaking. But I was like, whoa, this is actually not they might be onto something here.
I think Outback Steakhouse is the place to get a sloppy steak. That sounds perfect.
I was gonna say, yeah, like a more refined steakhouse might, as they do in the show, frown upon someone pouring water. But Outback has probably seen a lot worse, you know.
I mean, afterwards I went to Dan Flash's, you know, I had to just get the patterns.
The most complicated patterns possible. Claire, can I ask you a question? So, like, you mentioned that your like first exposure to the show is you had smoked a lot of weed, or you and your friends had smoked a lot of weed. Like, what's the like? I guess how does being high affect your enjoyment of the show? And like, sort of, what is the difference between watching it while high and watching it not high? I guess I'm just curious if you've thought about that at all.
Yeah, so I've definitely watched it, you know, under the influence, totally sober. I think, you know, being a little stoned definitely kind of elevates the absurdity. The very first sketch that they showed me was actually Dan Flash's. And my friend was at the time wearing a button-down shirt with that, you know, very complicated pattern on it. So we were watching the skit. People had been coming up to him all day long, like, oh, that man, that pattern's so complicated. And I was like, I don't get the reference. So they showed it to me that night. And we were just like looking at the screen, looking at him, just like laughing. He was like on the couch, like Tim Robinson's character is in that sketch. And it was a great way to be introduced into the show. Because like that type of sketch comedy is just so absurd. Like if you described that sketch to someone, it would not sound like it would be funny. But it is, and his delivery is just so funny. And I think that's why he didn't quite work out on Saturday Night Live. I think he was only in one single season. But I remember enjoying his skits, even though they didn't really align with, you know, the humor on the show. It's not for everyone, but so that was an interesting experience.
Yeah, I mean, I think the combination of like, I mean, he has a very like grating, I mean, intentionally grating voice, right? Like he's sort of like, he's speaking in a way that if someone were to do that in your physical presence, you would be like, ugh, get away from me, you know? And then on top of that, like, the sketches, the way they're written oftentimes, like the progression from point A to, you know, from the beginning to the end is, it's rarely like, I mean, the sloppy steaks one maybe is a bit of an exception to this, but like for the most part, there's not really much plot. I mean, like Dan Flash is like, all he does is sit there and complain about the guy, you know, not letting him talk about the shirts. Like there's not really, you know, like sort of the rise and the fall of it is often just like, how angry he is, and like sort of how detached his delivery is from like how normal human beings speak, you know. Like I feel like a lot of the like most quotable lines from the show are sort of like just have this very specific syntax that like nobody would ever use in real conversation. I can't think of a good example off the top of my head.
Has this ever happened to you?
Oh right, yeah, is that the toilet one. Yeah,
he does have such a like distinctive voice. Like, what the hell? Like, I don't know.
It's funny too, because like if you read or watch like interviews with him and his co-creators of the show, like he comes across as like a very reserved, like kind of socially awkward, but like, you know, not in the same way as the character on the show. Like he seems like someone who, I mean, the biggest thing is like people try to ask him like, where did you come up with the idea for the sketch, or like, explain your philosophy behind comedy, and like he just never really seems to be able to like articulate it. Like it just seems like it's like, yeah, I just thought it was funny. I don't know. Like like his demeanor seems very different from the characters he plays in the show, which makes sense. But yeah.
Yeah, some of the things, like I don't even know how you think of that without drugs. I guess his brain is just an interesting place to be, but I was just thinking of like the end of the calico cut pants sketch where it looks like he like opens a door and then just like walks into another dimension. And I was like, what? And then that's the end. So yeah, it's just, he's a unique guy for sure.
You gotta donate, man.
Yeah. You gotta give.
Yeah, that one goes to some dark places too. I mean, the other thing about the show, I think, is that it sort of does a nice job, I think, of like, and maybe the third season maybe sort of struggle with this a bit, where like, you know, most of the characters he's playing on the show are kind of in the same family, you know, similar personality, kind of similar problems. But like, you know, they show sprinkles in just enough sketches that don't involve him at all, or where he's like, I mean, the focus group one is actually a perfect example where he's kind of the normal guy in that one, for the most part, until he kind of turns, you know, he sort of like joins in on turning on that one guy like towards the end, all of a sudden there. But you know, like there's the Patty Harrison we mentioned is sort of plays the main role in a couple of them, especially in the first couple seasons. There's a the driver's ed one where, I mean, it's sort of like
that one. That
like
might
both
be
he problem. And her are sort the of like the wacky ones in that one, you know. And there's even like that one with Bob Odenkirk where Bob Odenkirk is like taking the like he's trying to, you know, Tim Robinson is trying to explain to his kid why they can't go get ice cream. And he's making up a little lie about it. And then Bob Odenkirk like takes it way too far, you know. So I feel like the show does a nice job of sort of like finding different like vessels to put, you know, to sort of put some of these same comedic ideas into, so you don't like get too tired of like of his way of speaking.
Two really random, well, one is a question we'll get to. I want to say Mark may have known, actually you both may know this, but I actually saw Patty Harrison's profile multiple times on
I was wondering if we were going to be allowed to talk about this. I do want to.
This is fun. Yeah. Like, so I was at USC, University of Southern California. And so not too far from, I guess, Hollywood-ish. And at the time, multiple times I ran into Patty Harrison's Hinge profile. Never matched, unfortunately, but it was hilarious. I remember, I think I took a few screen grabs just because I was like, oh shit, like this is like a celebrity. And like, I remember, but it was all very absurd things. It was like almost like she was in character, maybe trying to collect bits. Like one was like, oh, porn counts as a meal or something. And it's like just random stuff like that. Like, or it's like, this makes no sense.
Oh, that's perfect.
But they look like normal photos though. They weren't like headshot. They look like you would see from any other like average late 20s, early 30s person in LA.
She was really, she's definitely a standout, and I believe she's only in that single sketch in season 3. So hopefully she comes back, because I really enjoy her. Her delivery is just so bizarre.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's great.
Yeah. What was funny about that whole situation with Alex, not to belabor it, but it was just like I said, or like you said, Alex, you know, you were kind of, in your dating pursuits, you were sort of trying to find someone who like also appreciated the show. And then like you stumbled upon her, and so it's sort of like, well, like she probably appreciates it pretty well, you know, I would have to think.
Yeah.
So it's a shame that didn't work out, but
no, it would have been so cool to go on a date with like I'd say C-list maybe celebrity. She's not like super famous, but she has some fame for sure.
I mean, she's in the funniest show of all time. I think you should leave.
I don't know if I'd go that far, but it is very good. And by the way, that was going to be my next question, is like, what are your all-time, well, not maybe funniest, but what are your all, well, I guess it could be different answers, but your favorite, and it could be more than one, favorite skits and funniest skits for you personally. And feel free to, I'll list some of mine. So I love the tables one. That was really good for me. Oh, the date one with the nachos was good. Coffin flop, and then the baby one, and then the drive through. I think those are the
even ones. You just saying the names of them, I'm laughing. Like that's the thing. It's like, you know, I don't even have to watch the sketch. Like just thinking about it is funny. You know, like coffin flop is just, you know, like I'm looking at the list here, and like there's the Tammy Crafts one.
Porn cop TV. Think I'm just some dumb hit.
I'll let Claire go in a second here. I would just say, yeah, the sloppy steaks one remains my like number one pick. I also really like I'm trying to remember now what it's called, but the one with Vanessa Bayer in the first episode of the show where they're like taking the Instagram pictures and like she's doing all the weird captions. That one always makes me laugh a lot. I don't know. Yeah, we mentioned a good number of my favorites. Focus group. Claire, any other ones we haven't talked about?
Yeah, for me, I just remember the I tried to show it to my family. The only one that they like really reacted to in a positive way was the hot dog in the sleeve, where he can't skip lunch. Yeah, and he's like choking on the hot dog, and then it comes back with the hot dog vacuum, which I thought was clever. So all the hot dog related sketches, pretty much everything. The I think it's supposed to be like Shark Tank also has Patty Harrison in it. I just think she's so funny. So yeah,
those is that the one where she says like, "I can't stop drinking wine."
I can't stop.
Oh, that was so good. I forgot about that one.
That's right. She says, that's the thing. That's a perfect example, actually. She says, I can't stop having wine. And like just that one word being like a little off there, like that's much funnier than if she said drinking, which is what I remembered it as at first. That's like a perfect example of like, it's just these little sort of, everything is just slightly off in a way that is sort of hard to pinpoint sometimes.
Yeah, those are all really good. I don't know. Yeah, I think I mentioned some of mine. I'm trying to think of any other ones, but I think those ones.
I think one that I don't see people quote a lot is he shows up with his like husband to some party and they're a little bit late and they say, "Oh, I'm sorry, we're late." And then he sort of goes into that, taking it way too far. Fucking babysitter totally fucked us. And then he like shoves one of the people into like a china cabinet. He's like, "I told you not to question it."
That one's good. Yeah. I haven't thought about that one. It's also crazy how many celebrities he got on. Kind of as you referenced, like Bob Odenkirk.
Iowa Debris in the third season. I mean, his friend Sam Richardson, who he also had a show with on Comedy Central called Detroiters. That I don't know if you guys have seen. It's a different energy from this show, but it's pretty good. He's the guy, the host of the like pageants, like the Baby of the Year pageant or whatever. Mm-hmm. Those couple sketches there, like the ones with him, as much as I enjoy Sam Richardson, like I kind of appreciate those more than I laugh out loud at them, I guess. They're very funny, but it's sort of in a different way. It doesn't quite hit me in the same way. But yeah, I don't know.
The guy who plays Santa, I've seen him around. He was in Jury Duty. He just makes a very brief appearance and I was like, there's Santa. But yeah, those skits are more like, I don't like laugh from the absurdity. It's just, he's just funny.
I believe, and like, I know this is going to sound like I'm making it up, but like, I believe that guy's name in real life is Biff Whiff.
Biff Whiff. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't have an explanation that I can pull up here of why that would be someone's name, but, yes. he's in a couple of them actually, because I guess he appears again in the like Detective Crashmore one, which happens a little later on. He's also in Everything Everywhere All at Once, apparently, which I didn't remember at all. But anyway, that's just a side note. But yeah, and then the Tammy Crapps one, I think it's that one. The young girl is kind of the star of that. Is her name is Julia Butters. She was like the 10-year-old girl in the Quentin Tarantino movie Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Oh,
wow. She has like this big scene with Leonardo DiCaprio that's like, I mean, almost like alarmingly good. Like she's such a good actor and she's like 9 years old. It's like a bit scary, but you know, definitely contributes to that sketch, I think.
Those are all good. What was that article you sent me, Mark? Was it that it wasn't season four? Was that he was going to potentially do a different show?
Yeah. So, I mean, I was going to mention that because, I think this article doesn't say it, but I mean, I think the implication of this is that there may not be a fourth season of the show, or at least like not for a while, because just this week HBO gave a green light to a pilot of a new show, like a half hour scripted comedy. I guess I don't know if they said it's half hour, but like it's a scripted series called The Chair Company. I'll read the like one sentence that they gave of like what it's about. And it's written and executive produced by Tim Robinson and Zach Kanin, who's the co-creator of I Think You Should Leave, and also appears in a few of the sketches. After an embarrassing incident at work, a man played by Tim Robinson finds himself investigating a far-reaching conspiracy.
I don't know.
This sounds intriguing, and but you know, does I think suggest that maybe I think you should leave. Maybe you know, not happening for a while. Which is not a bad thing. I mean, you know, I think like we both said, season three seemed a little, maybe a little diminished from the first two. Which is actually another sketch that I liked that I forgot to mention from I think the second season. Alex, I feel like you didn't like this one as much, but I could be wrong about that. Is the one where he's wearing that like really like grotesque, like costume that like from head to toe, like the weird face, and he goes into the mall.
Yeah,
and he like at the last minute is like, I can't do it. Like,
yeah,
like that I don't even know why.
Carl Havoc.
Yes. That's another one that I feel like I see people use that, like the gif of him saying, I don't even know why, like, I don't want to be
around anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
I have seen that too.
You know, when like something bad happens in a sports game they're watching or whatever, you know? I don't know. The show has this weird way of sort of like, you know, reaching into the culture even when it sort of doesn't seem like it will, but yeah, so we'll see what the share company has to offer, hopefully in a couple of years. They gave us 3 seasons of this, so I feel like we should be grateful for what we have, even if in some ways it would be nice to.
I was gonna ask if you all have seen anything kind of similar. I feel like sketch comedy outside of SNL isn't very popular. Like Key and Peele is probably the biggest show in the last 10, 15 years. And then this might be number two if we exclude SNL, but it's like, other than maybe some stuff of like Nathan For You, I don't feel like I see like Tim Robinson-esque things, which I think does make it unique and give it that kind of novelty.
There is one show, it's an Adult Swim show, and actually Tim Robinson does make an appearance. It's called Your Pretty Face Is Going to Hell.
Oh, never
heard of it. And it's sort of that same absurd, it's a gross show. It's about like demons in hell, like working for the devil, but it's like a corporate like office. So they have this little like, you know, it's like a corporate logo on their polo shirts and it says like hell, and they're like wearing khakis, and it's just like, it's completely ridiculous. So there is an episode with Tim Robinson, and it's that same kind of like absurd, like people just like taking things way too far. There's lots of shenanigans. So that's really the only like
adjacent show. Live action or animated?
It's live action, but there's a lot of like pretty bad CGI. it's hard to explain, but that's a show that I would recommend to people who really, really like I Think You Should Leave, because it's like, I think they can tolerate that level of like absurdity and kind of like crass, obnoxious like humor.
That's a great recommendation. I've never heard of that. I mean, the only thing, I mean, Alex, you already said it, but like, I mean, I guess the I'll say two things. One, I mean, a show I would recommend to people if they like I Think You Should Leave is Detroiters, the Comedy Central series. I think it ran for 2 seasons. It was not particularly popular and got canceled afterwards, but basically Tim Robinson and Sam Richardson play best friends who are sort of like, they're working at like this like kind of low rent ad agency in like commercial, like they like do commercials for local businesses, and they get into all sorts of wacky hijinks. The tone is like a little bit more warm and sentimental than I Think You Should Leave, and like the characters are a little bit less like a little bit less like socially inept, but you know, there's some common threads there, and that show's very good. I don't think I've even seen the full series, but the parts of it that I did see, I really enjoyed. The Nathan Fielder example you gave, Alex, I feel like that's sort of like, if you want something that is kind of aiming for cringe, but kind of like, like even less endearing, I guess, in some ways, like even more remote and kind of like grim, like the rehearsal, the 6-episode series that he did a couple of years ago now, might be worth checking out. I don't even really, Claire, if you haven't seen it, it's sort of hard to describe what it's even about, but basically it's like Nathan Fielder is sort of playing a version of himself, mm-hmm. doing this experiment of like helping people rehearse things that they're going to do in their life that they're nervous about. Mm-hmm. So like the first episode is like he helps a guy who wants to confess to his friend that he lied to her about having a bachelor's degree. And like the whole like premise of it is that Nathan Fielder's character kind of takes this experiment way too far and like constructs a whole like this massive set to like replicate the bar that they're going to be in, and like insists on hiring all the same people who work at the real bar to like be at the fake bar to like create the right environment anyway. And sort of from there, this show goes on to sort of like further expose that like Nathan Fielder's attempt to do this for people is really like like a fool's errand, and kind of like he gets so deep into it that it kind of like eats its own tail. It's very hard to explain, but it's very compelling. It's sort of some of the humor in it, I think, maybe like overlaps with I Think You Should Leave, and then you're kind of laughing at someone who is sort of like completely ignorant of how like normal human interactions work. The main difference with that show is that, at least allegedly, it's sort of hard to tell where the fiction and reality lines blur, but allegedly the people he's interacting with are like real people, you know, as opposed to actors who are like completely on the same page in terms of what the project is. So I don't know, it could be interesting for people to check out, but but I do think the show is like pretty distinct, and like there aren't a lot of things that you can easily say like, oh, if you like this, you'll definitely like that, which I think says something about what makes it special. So
for sure. Those are actually most of my questions, but I was gonna ask, was there anything else about the show that we didn't talk about that we want to go into?
I don't know if we were talking about the possibility of a fourth season. Just based on how season 3 was received, and there really were less, you know, memorable skits from season 3. I'm not sure that like we need a season 4, unless like, you know, how much can he keep escalating and keep like stepping it up? Like there were good things about season 3, but I don't know if we need season 4 to like manifest. I think that it has such good like rewatchability. I've definitely seen, you know, seasons 1 and 2, like probably 3 or 4 times. I don't know. I think I would be happy if there was a season 4 one day, but I don't know. I don't know how that's going to look.
Yeah. I'm sort of, especially with the era of Hollywood movies, just remaking and sequels, I'd rather just end with the goodness and the good quality that we have than like churn it out, at the sake of quality.
We should mention too, I don't think it's coming anywhere near where I live. It may be coming to where you guys live, but there is a sort of live tour of the show happening right now. I read like a recap of the Los Angeles show. It's basically like Tim Robinson and Zach Kanan and a couple of the other people who are directly involved with the show kind of like screening clips of sketches that didn't make the final version of the show, and then asking like I guess the audience, but also like I guess maybe some famous guests or whatever, to like decide whether or not the sketch should be in the show. Mm-hmm. So it's not like reenacting the sketches from the original series, but it's sort of extending it. So I think it's mainly a West Coast thing, so I off the top of my head I don't know which cities it's going to, but that seems to be a way for them to kind of like extend the life of it without as you say, kind of diluting it and making more of it when it doesn't. You know, if the ideas aren't there, then, you know, forcing it maybe is not the best thing. I also agree, like, I don't know, not everything needs to be going on forever. You know, some things can just be discrete little things that worked at the time that they worked, and then, you know, you move on to something else. So, as you say, we'll always have this run of episodes that you know, where I think they captured something really, really special. So
I'm looking
glad to have it.
Tour dates, and unfortunately they look like they're all not
looks like there's no Seattle show.
No Seattle. So. Yeah.
Not even Portland. Yeah. I think,
well, I don't know.
I mean, maybe I could make my way back to LA. It seems like there's an LA show on May 11th, but that might be a little bit of a stretch.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I'll correct myself here, because I guess when I looked at it the previous time, I thought it was mainly a West Coast thing. But yeah, it's sort of
it is mostly West Coast.
Detroit, Nashville, Houston, Fort Worth, Phoenix, San Diego, San Francisco, LA. But yeah, there's not really like there's no, you know, DC area doesn't seem to have anything. And yeah,
people hating on the Washingtons, man, you know.
That's true. I guess we got three Washingtonians here in sort of different ways, although I live in Maryland, so I'm not a real Washingtonian anymore. But
Maryland is DC. It's like, it's all the same. It's the DMV, you know what
I guess. Yeah, I mean, I'm a lifelong Maryland resident, so I do want to make the distinction very clear. But though I do strongly support DC statehood, so I want to get that on the record in case there's any doubt. But yeah.
No taxation without representation.
Absolutely. Let's go.
I was telling Mark earlier, Claire, though, I do feel like there's some moments in my life that I feel like would be great I Think You Should Leave skits. Like my dentist has like was really into pickleball and like encouraged me to play pickleball and taught me pickleball. And that whole encounter, I feel like, would be a perfect skit. Or the time I went on a date and she invited like four of the dudes, that'd also be a good skit. Like, there's just so much potential there.
The pickleball one is really good, because like you can imagine, as it, like if the version of the sketch that I could envision is like, from what the story that you've told me is like, in real life you were like, yeah, sure, pickleball, like, but like in the show it would be like the person's like, I just want to like have my dentist appointment to be done, and the guy's like, have you played pickleball before? Like, it's so important,
that
you
is,
know, like
that is how I imagine it going. Yeah,
right. You see, when they take the pick, you know, I don't know what you do in pickleball, but yeah, anyway.
Oh, man. Well, I guess we could probably call it here unless there's anything else to add. But I just want to say thank you guys for coming on. I've been wanting to get out more episodes, and it's just like been a slow run for 2024. So I'm glad to have something on the books. And thank you both for your time.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Yeah, I mean, I'm most of the time these days, I'm a married non-parent of the East Coast. So anytime I can sort of put on the hat of a single dad of the Midwest, I jump at the opportunity. So yeah, thanks for having us. And it was nice conversation. So thank you.